Hey guys, Nathan at Duck River Honey, and today we are going to talk about swarm traps and bait hives. These are great tools that can help you to catch free bees, and we'll take a look at what bees are looking for when they are swarming and looking for a new home, as well as some of the pros and cons of the different types of traps. So beekeeping is a symbiotic relationship between honeybees and humans. And because of that, you've got two viewpoints. You've got the bee's point of view, and you've got the beekeeper's point of view. And I'm going to cover both of those angles. So a quick disclaimer before we get started, there is too much information to cover in the topic of honeybee swarm trapping to do it justice in just this one video. So this is going to be an ongoing series all through the spring. And if you hit the subscribe button and the notification bell, that will allow you to receive notifications of when I post new videos, and you'll be able to catch all of these in this series. So let's begin with the bee side of the equation. A colony of honeybees is made up of individual insects that cannot survive without the collective. That collective is a hive, and it is known as a superorganism. The main priority of that hive is the survival of the hive. That's the number one priority, is the survival and success of that hive. Once that hive has checked the survival and success box, they move on to priority number two, which is reproduction. And the way the honeybee colony reproduces is through swarming. What typically happens is that successful, big, bustling, very crowded colony in the spring of the year, when there's plenty of nectar and pollen flowing, 30 to 70% of the bees in the colony will leave with the existing queen to start a new colony. So after the swarm leaves the mother hive, it has to make a decision on where it wants to move to. Basically, it's got to pick out a new house. And here is where this is valuable to us as beekeepers, because if you give the bees a swarm trap or a bait hive that is the best piece of real estate in the neighborhood, they will move into your swarm trap or bait hive with no doing on your part. They will make the decision and they will move in, and then you have captured a new colony of honeybees. So to understand what bees are looking for in choosing a new house, I've got some reading that I'll recommend to you. The first one is Honeybee Democracy by Dr. Thomas Seeley. This is an absolutely fascinating book, cannot recommend it enough. It deals more specifically with how the bees make that decision. It also talks about what they're looking for in their new home. I've got another publication here by Dr. Thomas Seeley called Bait Hives for Honeybees. And this was written quite a bit earlier than Honeybee Democracy. I believe that this was published in 1989, and it is a direct result of some of the work that Dr. Seeley did when he was younger. I may be wrong about this, but I think that he was still in grad school at the time, and he wanted to study wild honeybee colonies to see how those colonies organize themselves and how they live in the wild. So what he did is he learned how to beeline, basically track a bee back to its hive, and he identified a bunch of bee trees out in the woods. And then as part of his research, he would euthanize that colony. He'd kill all the bees so none could escape. He would cut the tree down and saw it in half. By doing that, he could weigh and measure everything. He could count the bees, he could count the cells in the honeycomb, he could see how much honey they had, see where the entrance was and how big it was, and he could also pour sand in the cavity and see how big the cavity was. So by doing this, he found some commonalities among all of these honeybee colonies. And guys, I'll tell you that this is the value of university research, because you and I don't have the time and money to put into that kind of learning. But because he was able to do this, we've got this information today, and it's incredibly valuable in a lot of different ways. So he took what he learned and he put together this publication called Bait Hives for Honeybees. And a few pages back, he has got a section on recommendations for bait hive design. And I'm going to go through these one by one. I'll put it up on the screen so that you can follow along. So what honeybees are looking for in a new house? Number one, height, about 15 feet or 5 meters above the ground. Number two, shade and visibility, well shaded but highly visible. Bees avoid or abandon bait hives in direct sun. Number three, Distance from parent nest, not important. A quick note, guys, I somewhat disagree with this one because if you put a bait hive 100 feet from a feral colony, they're going to find that swarm trap. If you put it 10 miles away, the likelihood that they're going to find it is not very good at all. So the swarm will move a good distance, but they have to find it to be able to move into it. Number four, total entrance area, about 1.5 to 2 square inches. Number five, entrance shape, not important. Number six, entrance position, near the floor of the hive. Number seven, entrance direction, facing south preferred, but other directions are acceptable. Number eight, cavity volume, about 1.4 cubic feet or 40 liters. This is about the volume of one standard 10-frame Langstroth hive body. Number nine, cavity shape, not important. Number 10, dryness and air tightness, dry and snug, especially at the top. Number 11, type of wood, various types acceptable, many types of trees have been occupied, bees may avoid new lumber. Number 12, odor. The odor of beeswax is attractive. However, putting in pieces of comb is not advisable as comb also attracts wax moths and can harbor disease. Guys, that's the end of his list. I'm going to add one more to it that I think is important, and that is empty space within the bait hive. And we'll find out later why that is important, because it really does play a big part in my decision making in making these swarm traps. All right, guys, so that's a look into the bees' point of view and what they're looking for in a new home. And now let's look at the beekeeper's side of the equation. And my side of the equation is much simpler than the bees'. I am interested in minimizing my time, money, and aggravation and maximizing my chances of catching swarms. So when I look at bait hives or swarm traps, I am judging them based on those three criteria: how easy they are to use, how much they cost, and how much time and aggravation they're costing me. So last spring, I was able to experiment with several different types of swarm traps, and I learned a few things, and I've done a lot of research on those since then. And I'm going to share some of what I've learned. So the first two styles of swarm traps I want to talk about, I actually don't have an example of here, and that may give you an indication of what I think about them. The first style is the wood fiber pot that you can get at the bee supply houses. I checked pricing on those this morning, and you can get five for somewhere in the $25, $26 a piece range. So those are pretty expensive for what they are. The second style is a 5-gallon bucket trap, which you can make very affordably, $5-6 a piece. I've not made any of those, but I found a good video on how to do it, so I'll link you to that in the description if you want to go that route. So in my opinion, both those trap styles suffer from a problem that would cause me aggravation, which is one of my three judgment criteria, and that is cutout removal. So since there are no frames inside those traps, the bees will go to the top back away from the entrance typically, and they'll start drawing comb down. If you leave them in that trap for a while, if you don't get to it soon, they'll build a lot of comb in there. You'll be cutting the comb out of that swarm trap and trying to put it into frames and get it into a hive. If I don't have to do that amount of work, I don't want to. I want there to be frames and foundation all the way across the top, so the bees don't have room to build wonky comb that causes me issues. I want them to use their resources in building wax that can be reused easily when I put them into a hive. So that's criteria number one, no cutouts. So I actually caught two swarms last year out of a swarm trap very similar to this. So this has got a 1/2-inch plywood top, plywood spacer, plywood bottom, and a medium super with 10 frames in it. The entrance is 2 3/4-inch holes that actually touch in the middle, so it gives you an 1.5-inch total hole area. And on the inside of this, I actually stapled some 1/2-inch hardware cloth to help keep birds from building nests in it. Now I'd like to circle back to empty space in the swarm trap and talk about that in more detail. I did not find this in Dr. Seeley's work, but in my research and learning about swarm traps through forums and YouTube videos, I have heard many people mention that the swarm trap needs to have a void or space inside it so the swarm can enter quickly and then go up and organize themselves. The proper swarm trap size is very similar to a 10 frame deep Langstroth hive body. But if you put 10 deep frames in that Langstroth hive body, they don't have empty space. And it's my belief that they won't move into it as readily because they don't have that empty void. So I saw a video done by Mike Berry where he caught a swarm in a deep hive body and he had deep frames in it, but he left a void in the middle. And the bees moved in and the first thing they did was to start building comb off the lid. They did not build comb on the frames. So at that point, you're doing a cutout, which is aggravating. So I want the bees to be encouraged to build on the foundation and they need a void. Therefore, I've got the void on the bottom of the hive and then foundation and frames all the way across the top. So they don't have much choice in building comb except to build off that foundation because they're going to go to the top of the cavity and then build down. So in sizing, this particular swarm trap is 46.3 liters. And again, I caught two swarms out of this exact trap. When I first started doing this, I used a ladder to get the swarm trap up as high as I could, which would be about 15 feet or so. The problem came when I was 15 foot up a ladder, leaned against a tree, with this thing balanced on my shoulder, trying to get the ratchet strap off, and it's nighttime because you got to get the bees down in the night, and this box is now full of fairly agitated bees. That got pretty sketchy pretty quickly, so I learned very, very fast no ladders when doing this. So after that experience, I made a rule, and that was I would not put up a swarm trap unless I could back my truck up to the tree and stand on the tailgate to hang the swarm trap. No ladders. The next style that you'll see are these two. These are pretty easy to use. This one will hold six medium frames or deeps with an empty space on the bottom, and it's got a hole at the bottom of the cavity. And if you'll notice, I've got an oversized entrance disc here so that after the swarm moves in and I go to move them, it's really easy for me to shut them in, but still make sure that they've got plenty of ventilation. So I really do like this style entrance disc. Now of these two traps, this one holds six frames and this one only holds five. So this one is right at 40 liters and this one is at about 50 liters. And I caught swarms in both of these. Guys, this is a side note, but it's a really cool story. I actually saw the swarm move in to this box here, and they had a virgin queen with them. And I know it was a virgin queen because while I was watching the bees move in, she landed on the lid here and had a drone on her back. She was there for a few seconds and then they took off again. So I actually witnessed a virgin queen getting mated by a drone. I feel really fortunate because I would imagine that that's something that's pretty rare. So the next swarm trap system I'll talk about is this one, which is what I'm going to be using a lot of this year. And there's some advantages to this. So I'll run you through the equipment that I've got here. This is a very affordable plywood solid bottom board. I've got an entrance reducer. I've got a spacer made out of a 1x4. And then I've got a medium super with 10 frames with a migratory lid on top. I want to note that if you want to make this system more affordable, it is very easy to make a plywood spacer with a plywood bottom and then use a plywood top in this same system. I'm using the bottom board and the migratory lid this year because I've got the equipment and it's part of my overall operations strategy. But if I were in a place where I was worried about potential theft, then I would definitely be going this route because I'd have less invested in it if one happened to walk off. So guys, now I'm going to talk about some of the advantages that I see to this system. First and foremost is getting it up into the tree. I put the platform on first, and it's easy to get the platform up. I've got a chain and quick link here so I can level it to the tree's lean. That works well. And this thing folds flat. So I take this off, and this folds flat in the off season for storage. This box here does not fold down. I've got three of these, and I'm constantly shuffling them around because they're in the way. The only good place to store them is in the rafters. You hang them off the rafters or something, and even then you have to worry about dirt daubers getting in them and stuff like that. So these are a kind of a pain for storage purposes, and they're also single use. Now, the amount of money I have invested in this platform, well, I'm using recycled decking boards from my brother-in-law's deck when he replaced the boards in it. I bought some screws because I didn't have 2 inchers, and I bought a door hinge for $3.49. The cable, the quick link, S hook, and chain, I already had. So I've got less than $4 in this thing. And it folds flat, and it makes it easy to get it up and down off the tree. Now, when you move on to the swarm trap itself, I'm using a solid bottom board, migratory lid, medium super with 10 frames, a spacer, and an entrance reducer. The only part of this that is not part of my normal operation is a spacer. The rest of it is part of my normal gear. So I've got to store this stuff anyway. I don't mind having this. It's not in my way because I can use it throughout my operation. This spacer, I can use this in certain applications. You can use it to put a feeder on top of a hive. You can use it to emergency feed. And this platform and this spacer, for me, are a lot cheaper than building these. Now, another advantage of this system is that there are times when you can't get the entrance facing south. The tree's lean or whatever is going to force you to face it a different direction. So with this system here, I can turn this hive, and if this was faced east, I've now faced the entrance to the south. So I've got some variation there, and this will work for a lot of different situations. Another huge advantage that I see is because this spacer is so affordable to make and such a simple solution, it allows me to vary my swarm trap size. Now, with the experience that I had last year, I had a 46 liter swarm trap, I had a 50 liter swarm trap, I had a 39 to 40 liter swarm trap. I caught my largest swarm last year out of a bait hive that consisted of a shallow and a medium. So the shallow on the bottom was empty, and then the medium had frames in it, and that one was about 59 liters. So this system also allows me to very quickly and easily vary the size of my swarm trap. And if you think back to bee biology, if you've got a really healthy colony, they're going to cast a primary swarm in the springtime if they can. That mother hive will then have some virgin queens emerge. And if that hive has a high enough population and is strong enough, those virgin queens can take after swarms. So what I found last year was that in my smaller swarm traps, I tended to catch smaller swarms. And in my bigger swarm traps, I tended to catch bigger swarms. It's my belief that those bigger swarms were probably primary swarms, and the smaller swarms may very well have been after swarms or cast swarms with virgin queens. Now, another point about swarms is bees don't fly if it's cold or if it's raining. So one thing I learned this past year is we had 4 or 5 days where it was cold and rainy, and then on a Friday, it warmed up to 72 degrees and it was calm. And I knew that that day I would be getting swarms move into my traps. I think I had 2 or 3 move in on that one day. And this brings us to a very, very important point in honeybee swarm trapping. You cannot catch a swarm in a swarm trap that already has a swarm living in it. I'll say that again. If a colony is already living in your swarm trap, that swarm trap cannot catch another swarm until you take that colony out and hive it and put a swarm trap back in that spot. So when trying to maximize my success rate and reduce my time, money, and aggravation, when I spread out all around the county and gain landowner permission to put up swarm traps, if I think it's a good spot, I'm going to put up two or even three swarm traps. And I'm going to vary the sizes. I'll put up a big one, I'll put up a medium-sized one, and I'll put up a fairly small one. That way, if there's a colony in the neighborhood that casts a primary swarm and an after swarm, I've got houses for both those to move into, and I can catch both. So with this style swarm trap, I can use a small spacer to make a 39-liter box, a medium spacer to make a 48-liter box, a shallow and a medium to make a 59-liter box, or a double medium to make a 62-liter box. And believe me, guys, I will have some double medium bait hives around my home apiary because I've got some strong hives. And if my swarm prevention doesn't work, it's very likely I could catch a major primary swarm in this size box. Another advantage of this style swarm trap is as I cycle old equipment out of my active operation, I can put it into swarm trap use. Because again, bees find that bee smell extremely attractive. So if they can tell that a colony has been living in this box, that's going to add to the attraction of this swarm trap. So another advantage of this system for me specifically is that I use all medium equipment for my hive bodies, my supers, my nuke boxes, and my swarm traps. So I've got one piece of equipment that I use in multiple ways, and that brings my cost down in total. So a typical nuke box size would be 5 deep frames, which equates to about 7.5 medium frames in total comb area. So I can take this medium super and put a 2-frame cap and ladder frame feeder in here that will hold a gallon of syrup, and then I fill the rest with 8 frames. That is my nuke box. So when I catch this swarm, all I have to do is bring this whole thing back to my apiary, pull this spacer out, drop it down, put the feeder in, and pour the feed to them, and I've got my nuke box started. Guys, I really hope that you found this video helpful. If you have, then hit the like button. That helps to get it out to other beekeepers. And if you want to follow along in the swarm season with me this year, again, this is going to be a series of videos. Then hit the subscribe button and the bell for notifications. That'll let you know when I post a new video. Again, there's a lot of material to cover and I want to be as comprehensive as possible. So if you have questions or comments, I'd really appreciate you leaving that below. Until next time.